Well, good morning. Good morning, everybody. Glad to see everyone here today. The sun is shining outside, and hopefully a little bit drier weather to come, but I guess we've not gotten any more rain than God thought we needed. So but just a few months, we'll be hot and dry and wanting it to rain again. So God knows what we need when we need it. Glad to see everybody here this morning. Brother Ray is gone to, a pig show, and they're on their way back probably today. So we've got a guest speaker here today. He's been here before. Brother Mark Yateman is going to come bring our message today. He's certainly no stranger to us. We have a few announcements we need to make before we get started. The youth camp, July 5th through the 9th, a $50 deposit per child is due in March. There will be no food boxes this week, so that'll be delayed for a week. The ladies, or the Camden Baptist event, has been canceled for those that signed up. A text was sent out about other arrangements. So if you're planning to go but hadn't signed up, please let Katrina Driggers know. Wild Game Supper coming up March the 6th with Clay Dreyer will be our guest speaker. Now it's going to be a different format for our Wild Game Supper this year. It's going to be just a more of a fellowship and a supper that evening, with Clay speaking that night and the next day, Sunday. So let's church members be here for that. And don't be afraid to invite somebody that's not a church member that you think maybe need to hear what Brother Clay has to say. So let's remember that also. Starting Wednesday, March the 3rd, we're starting our Wednesday night classes back up. Supper will start at 6, so let's remember that and try to remind those kids that are on Wednesday night. It'll be coming back that in March. The RA's Camperee, March the 5th and 6th, Lake Windy. Meet at the church at 3:30. And if you have any questions, see Brother Taylor Sweeney about that. Do have an announcement I was asked to make. We have the honor this morning of some gentlemen being here with us that are the basketball champions for the SECC. That's the Southern Christian School Conference, 6 years in a row. And we were told not to embarrass them, so y'all guys want to just stand up and let everybody see who you are? Come on now. You can come on. Come on. Come on. Good effort there. Any other announcements that need to be made this morning? If not, let's start off this morning with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we're just so thankful today of your blessings, thankful to even the breath of life that you give us, Lord. We're just thankful we can come to a place like this that's cool and dry and worship you in peace and comfort, Lord, and we're not afraid of anybody coming in and harming us. We just thank you for that, Lord. We take it for granted sometimes. Lord, we just ask that you be with us today, be with the music service, the songs that are sung. Pray that it'll be uplifting to you. Be with Brother Mark as he comes and presents your word. Just hide him behind the cross, Lord. Give him the words that you would have us to hear today. Lord, I pray also for that lost person that may be among us that just needs a touch from you, Lord. Pray that they would turn their life to you today before it's eternally too late. Whatever we do here and we say here today, we just want to honor and glorify your name. In Christ's name, amen.
morning, during the week, and asked me if I would come and do a couple of songs. I told him I'd be honored to.
And I apologize for not being in church a good little bit here lately. This chemo, that stuff is rough and it's real. And also my wife is going through something. She's going to finally, we got her scheduled to have surgery this week. So remember her in prayer. Also, I got a first cousin that her son has always been in trouble with gangs and stuff. And she's a sweet Church of God Christian. And she got word this morning he hung himself, you know, and that'd be terrible. I'm sure it is with her. But, you know, that's a storm she's going to go in right now. I heard we sung at a benefit sing last night, my group did, and for a lady, and her husband just killed himself, shot himself. So somebody said last night, when the storms come, God won't just bring you to it, he'll bring you through it. And that's so true. But anyway, here's a song about trials. Y'all pray for me. So many times I question certain circumstances, things I just couldn't understand. But many times in trials, my weakness blurs my vision, my frustration's out of hand. But it's then I am reminded I've never been forsaken. I've never had to stand the test alone. And when I look at all my victories, that old spirit rises up in me. Through the fire, my weakness has been made strong. He never promised that the cross could not get heavy, the hill would not be hard to climb. No, he has ever said, but just remember when you're standing in the valley of decision and the adversary says give in, just hold on, our Lord will show, and he'll take you through the fire again. I know within myself that I would surely perish, but if I trust the mighty hand of God, he'll shield the flames again. He never promised that the cross could not get heavy and the hill would not be hard to climb. Oh, and he never offered our victory without fighting, but he said help would always come in time. So just remember when you're standing in the valley of decision and your eyes, just hold on, our Lord will show, and he'll take you through the fire again. So just hold on, our Lord will show up. Yes, he will. He'll take you through the fire. Thank you. I told my wife to get these songs ready, and I should have read them and critiqued them. But you believe that it's going to come right out of that computer. Wrong. Here's a song I picked this morning. Excuse me. mouth gets plumb cotton mouth when I get up here to sing. I chose this song here this morning because Romans 8 and 1 says, there is therefore no condemnation in them who walk in Christ Jesus, because God has covered you. He has covered you. I'm not going to preach or nothing, but I want to introduce this song right. John 17:15. It's a prayer that Jesus wouldn't pray. He said, I pray not that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from all unrighteousness. And he was praying to God. And what that means is when you get saved, God's blood from the cross of Jesus comes down and falls all over Christians. And they're covered with the blood of Jesus Christ so that God can't see your doings of being wrong, because you're protected. That's why I said 8 and 1 says there's therefore no condemnation. But Satan wants to try to tell you for every little thing you do wrong, you go into hell, and you can't trust God for salvation of first, once saved, always saved. But he's a liar. He's a liar, and he's from hell. When God forgives you, he casts your sins as far as east is to west. And if there's somebody here this morning that's hung up on something that you just can't forgive yourself, God's telling you, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm through with it. Press on toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So if anybody in here is kind of hung up with some condemnation, rebuke it and declare it by the word of God that it be removed. You don't deserve to walk with it. He set you free. Through tear-filled eyes I sought for your forgiveness, for a failure that had happened in my life. I was haunted by a memory that wouldn't let me live in peace. Lord, let your mercy end this pain and strife. But I could tell you had forgotten, Lord, what I was talking about. 'Cause you weren't even bothered with what was taking me down. I saw grace and forgiveness was accomplished, no doubt, when you could not remember what I was talking about. Oh, it amazes me how that old cross could handle sin forever with just one drop of your blood. God's work of grace completed, sin's hold on me defeated, so far removed the past cannot be seen. I could tell you had forgotten, no, with what I was talking about, 'cause you weren't even bothered what was bringing me down. 'Cause I saw grace and forgiveness was accomplished, no doubt, when you could not remember what I was talking. I saw grace and forgiveness. God, remember, Lord, have mercy. What I was talking about. Thank you.
Lord, that was an awesome song, that last one. Lord, I just thank you so much for the truth that when we come to you and asking you to help us once again with something we've already professed and proclaimed and given to you, that you don't even know what we're talking about. Father, I'm thankful that the forgiveness that you give is permanent. It is eternal. And when this world accuses, when this world tries to bring us down, your word stands firm in the fact that your son gave his life for me, that I might be saved. I thank you for the gift, and I thank you, Father, that you gave me the strength to accept it. And Lord, I pray now that you just help me and each and every one of us continue to live in the fact that we belong to you. Father, we thank you for this hour, this time. We ask for your blessings on the offerings. Help us, Lord, to give as you have given us. In the name of Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen.
To us. He's been here several times. Brother Mark Yakeman's going to come. Oh, children's church. I'm sorry. Got to buy it. Brother Mark's going to come. He's with the Set Free Ministries down in Waynesville area. And he does a wonderful work down there with those guys. So, Brother Mark, if you'll come and bring us God's word.
Children sure are a joy. I'd forgotten what a joy they truly are until we just had our first granddaughter. And I was reminded again what an amazing gift God gives unto us. Precious little lives to mold and shape and, you know, encourage and help in this life. It's always good to see children among God's people. There's a lot of gatherings that there's not any children left. And I was just thinking when the children were leaving, what a blessed congregation you are to have children in your midst. It's a great, great privilege. The new life, the hope for the next generation, it's also a great responsibility that we have as a church family. I know that parents have the primary responsibility, but as a church family, God has entrusted those precious little souls to guide and to direct in the ways of the Lord, to raise them to know God and love God and walk with Him. I assure you, the light of Christ shining in and through His people in this world is the hope of the world. It's the whole way of real truth and real life and purpose and meaning. And you are truly a blessed congregation to have such a gift here in your midst. If you have your copy of God's Word, I want to invite you to turn with me to the book of James, chapter 4. James chapter 4, we'll be looking at the first 10 verses together. And today as a whole, I feel like the Lord has led in such a way as to discuss the path to peace. James chapter 4, verse 1 through 10 will be the text, and we'll be thinking about the path to peace. And while you're turning there, just a quick update with the ministry, Set Free South Georgia. We are a ministry that deals with men caught up in addiction. We very simply teach them a personal relationship with Christ and biblical principles, not only to overcome their addiction, but to live the lives that God has planned and purposed for them here upon this earth, one in which it has eternal hope and eternal life in Christ Jesus. We're in the process of adding hopefully 24 to 26 more beds at the facility, and we greatly appreciate your prayers, your support. It's certainly a ministry for the church, not just one congregation, but the church as a whole. We are called as God's people to address the issues within our culture with the hope of the gospel, and to meet people there in their crisis point, and to share with them the truth of God and the love of God and the power of God to transform a life. It's truly the hope for every cultural problem and issue that we have within our day. And I greatly appreciate and give you thanksgiving and God thanksgiving for what he does in and through this congregation in behalf of the work God's called me unto. James chapter 4, beginning in verse 1, reading through verse 10. This morning, we will go through the first 5 verses in the message, and then we'll look at the remaining verses this evening as we come back together. But let's read all 10 verses together. Beginning in verse 1, James, the half-brother of Christ, writes, and he says, "What is the source of quarrels and conflict among you? Is it not the source your pleasures that wage war in your members? You lust and do not have, so you commit murder. And you are envious and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, so that you may spend it on your pleasures. You adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is hostility towards God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you think that the Scripture speaks to no purpose? He jealously desires the Spirit which he has made to dwell in us, but he gives a greater grace. Therefore, it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be miserable and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt you." Let us pray together. Our Father in heaven, as we join our hearts and minds in your holy and magnificent presence, Father, we stand in awe of your glory, your power, your majesty. Father, we are mindful that you are the one true God. You are the everlasting God. Lord, you have no beginning, and you will have no end. Lord, we are mindful that from your own wisdom and your own knowledge, you spoke forth, and all that there is became. Father, we are mindful, Lord, that you even now hold all that there is in the palm of your hand. Lord, you are sovereignly and eternally working in the midst of mankind from generation to generation to generation to the end of time, Lord, for your glory and for the good of all who will call you Father through faith in Christ Jesus. Father, we are mindful that you are the one that raises up kingdoms. And Father, you are the one that brings them down. Father, you simply speak and the earth shakes. Father, you speak and the mountains are cast into the seas. Father, you speak and those that are dead come to life. Father, you speak, and Lord, those with illnesses and sicknesses are made well. Father, you speak in the midst of chaos and calamity, and there is peace. Father, you speak to the wind and the waves within our life. Father, you alone are God, and to know you, the one true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent, is eternal life. Father, thank you for allowing us, Lord, your people in this place, to come boldly into your throne room, into the holy of holies, into your very presence, Lord, and call upon your name, and Father, to seek your precious face. Father, as we meet in this place today, we recognize and we verbalize the greatest need that we have is to hear from you, the living God, and to be with you, the only God. Father, there is no greater need for our souls, for our lives, than to be in your presence. Lord, to hear your counsel. Father, we do not need the counsel of man. Father, we do not need the things of this world for our flesh more than we need you. We need you, Father, the very most. Father, I do pray for every soul in this place. Still us in our hearts and our minds. Lord, many of us came into this place today and we have so many worries and stresses and strains. Father, many of us are like Martha, running to and fro in this life, trying to get all the loose ends collected together and brought into calm. And Father, I pray, though the loose ends still flap, God, I pray that you would still us in your presence today. And Father in heaven, I do pray that your Holy Spirit would breathe and speak life unto every soul in this place through your word. Father, I pray that you would show each one of us where we stand in your holy presence. Father, show us the truth. God, not what we want to think of ourselves, not what we say is truth, but God, in light of your truth, reveal our hearts unto us. Father, let us see Lord, no matter how good or how bad, help us to see who we truly are. And Father, please help us to see your glory. Help us to see your splendor, your majesty. And Father, as you make truth known to every one of us in this place, Father, any steps of faith, God, that you have brought us into this place today, Lord, to make, Father, I pray that excuses would not deter us. Father, I pray that fear would not deter us. Lord, I pray doubt would not deter us. But God, I pray that out of fear of you, the one and only God and King, Lord, that we would be compelled, Lord, unto obedience to you. Lord, for those that need salvation, Father, I pray that you might draw them today. Lord, that you would make known their need and you would make known your grace and love and kindness to them through your precious Son's atoning death upon the cross. Lord, the victory and justification through his resurrection. And Lord, I pray that from their heart they may turn from this life, turn from this world, yielding to Christ Jesus for salvation, and Lord, committing to be his disciple, even in this place today. And God, I pray for every one of us, your children. Father, I pray that that salvation work that you have begun through faith in Christ, that you, by the power of your Spirit, would continue it forth within each one of us. Father, I pray that you would compel us to die unto ourself more today and to live more unto you in spirit and in truth, even today in this place. God, if we have sin within our life, disobedience unto you, Father, if we have stepped out of your will, I pray that the power of your Spirit would grip our inmost being. And Father, I pray that we would be broken and we would be grieved over our disappointment unto you, our disobedience to you. And Father, that we may come even to an altar and confess, Lord, that we have stepped off course, we have stepped away. And God, I pray that as we confess that you would be faithful and just to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, restoring proper fellowship with you, our Lord and our God. Father, I pray for every heavy heart in this place. Father, I pray that you would show that you are the God of all comfort. And Father, I pray that you would bring comfort to those weary souls. Father, that you would draw them near. God, that you would remind them of your promises and your truth, of your presence in their life. And Father, I pray that you would encourage them. Father, I do pray, Father, for each person in this place who has grown tired and weary. Father, in doing your will, Lord, they've been standing and standing, and Lord, they have faced opposition, maybe from a spouse, maybe from co-workers, maybe from the community, Father. And they are just bone tired within their soul, within their physical being. Father, I pray that they may run unto you, Lord Jesus, and they would find rest for their souls. God, that they would just be intimate with you and real with you in sharing their hurts and their frustrations. And God, I pray that you would encourage and lift them up and send them forth out of this place empowered by your divine Spirit. And Father, I pray for every one of us, no matter where we are, and no matter why we came here today, Father, I pray that every one of us would go from this place with a testimony that today we have seen the living God. He is still high and lifted up, seated at your right hand, Father, and he is glorious in his splendor and his majesty and might. And he lives among us. And he is doing a living work, a holy work, all for the glory of Jesus, who is Lord. Father, I do ask that you would set me aside. Father, please speak your word here today. We need to hear from you. God, we need to see you. May it be so now, and I pray it in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. There is much conflict in our world. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to know that. You simply look around you, and there's conflict going on. For some of us in this place, there's conflict in our most intimate circles. For some of us, there's conflict at home, in our very dwelling place, day in and day out. Conflict between spouses, husbands and wives. Conflict with parents and children. If you have children, I assure you, there's going to be conflict. They come and they are so sweet and they are so cute, but they grow up. They take on their own personality. They begin to exercise that sin nature that we're all born with. All of a sudden, your guidelines and what you have to say is not important to them. They're seeking to make their own way. They're seeking to do their own thing. And sometimes the conflict is in our own homes. There's certainly conflict going on in our communities. Listen, every day there's news of hostilities and divisions and brokenness. We definitely know today, looking at our country, that there is great conflict going on. You and I look about us and there's uprisings here and there's uprisings there. There's this person saying this, another person saying that. This group wants this. The other group wants that. There's great conflict all around us. For those of you who are followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, there's a conflict going on that's closer than any of these. And that conflict is within. It's within our own hearts. It's within our own souls. It goes on in our own minds, day in and day out. See, when we come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, listen, God does a supernatural work within us. It's one that is mind-blowing. It's unfathomable to the minds of men. And that is, he removes our heart of stone and he places within us a heart of flesh. He puts his Holy Spirit within us as a seal guaranteeing our inheritance until the day of our redemption. And there is a conflict that goes on within. See, before salvation, we have lived for ourselves like the rest of mankind. Listen, you don't have to teach a child to be selfish. We come that way. That's who we are. Listen, you don't have to teach a child to say, mine. They can say, mine. You don't have to teach a child to say, no. Listen, they learn how to say, no, real easy. You do not have to teach a child to be selfish. You have to teach them to share. You have to teach children to be kind. And until we come to faith in Christ, until the living God brings conviction in our soul of our desperate need for his forgiveness of salvation, and listen, he reveals the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ that through his own son's death, burial, and resurrection, he desires to pardon us, to forgive us, to wash us as white as snow, until he brings us to that point and we turn our back on this world turning our back on ourselves, our own will, and yielding to God through faith in Christ, to His will and His purpose and His plan within our life, until that very moment we all live for ourselves. But at salvation, God's Spirit comes to live within. And I want you to understand, because you are saved, if you belong to Christ, there is going to be a conflict within you till death do you part. And the wonderful hope that we have is this is the only conflict we're going to face. See, in death do you part means we leave these old bodies behind. Listen, that desiring not to do what God wants me to do, that'll be gone forever. Me telling God no and resisting Him and listen, struggling over His will and what I want, it will no longer be for God's children. We will be free, and be free indeed in the presence and glory of God forever and ever and ever. And all God's people say, amen. The Apostle Paul knew this battle within. In Romans chapter 7, he concludes, "What a wretched man am I! Who will save me from this body of death?" And he says, "Thanks be to God through our Lord Jesus Christ." There is a conflict going on in you. There is conflict going on in your home, in your community, in this country, in this world. And I want you to know that there is a path to peace. And I want you to understand, the Republicans don't have it, and the Democrats don't have it. The Lord Jesus Christ has it. He alone has it. Now, before we get to the path of peace, which, Lord willing, we'll get there tonight, we need to understand the source of the conflict. Now, I want you to understand, most people in this place, we're going to have a real hard time swallowing this. Because most of us think that our conflict is them. Most of us think that our conflict is him. Our conflict is her. Our conflict is without. And dear friend, I want you to understand that if you think your conflict is on the outside, that it's somebody else or something else, you will not find peace. Where does conflict begin in your life and in my life? Well, James tells us this morning. Notice, if you would, in verse 1, he says, "What is the source of quarrels and conflict among you?" Good question. Lord, what's going on in my life? Why is my spouse at me and I'm at my spouse? Why are we as parents at our children? What's the source of it, Lord? Is it not the source your pleasure that wage war in your members? Dear friend, I want you to understand that the greatest enemy to you is not the world. The greatest enemy to you is not Satan. The greatest enemy to you are not demons. The greatest enemy to you and to me is me. It's me. It's not them or him or her. It's not those. Man, we love blaming the devil for things when it ain't nothing but me. Oh, that devil. He's doing all this and he's doing all of that. Dear friend, I want you to understand, if you think the source of your conflict is something else, you are denying the truth of God's word. I am the source of my conflict. You are the source of your conflict. It's our own desires. It's our own seeking of pleasure for ourselves, seeking my will, seeking my comfort, seeking what I believe, what I want. That is the source of conflict. The Apostle Paul told young Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3 that there's going to be terrible times in the end days. And you know what he tells young Timothy there in verse 3 of chapter 3? He says, people will be lovers of themselves. I tell my guys all the time, don't get tripped up in what you say. Do you understand that we can deceive ourselves through our word? See, we can say anything. We can learn how to say the right thing. But listen to me. Me saying the right thing does not change my heart. There's only one that can change my heart, and that's the living God. But listen, I have to be real, and I have to agree with him, and what he says is the truth, not what I want to be the truth. He says in the last days, people will be lovers of themselves. Listen, you don't have to talk even church members into doing things if that's what they want. Listen, let's take a vote on making ourselves more comfortable and our worship more what I want it to be. Boy, you can get a unanimous vote. But bring up, because the Spirit of God leads us to sell the church and go out into our community and be evangelists telling the gospel. Oh, no. That ain't what we want. You don't want to be uncomfortable. I don't want to be uncomfortable. But I want to remind us as the church, our Lord and Savior did not come to be comfortable in this life. As a matter of fact, he came to make himself nothing, to set himself aside. I want you to understand, it was the Father's will for him to be rejected by man, for him to be mocked, for him to be ridiculed, for him to be beaten beyond recognition, for him to be spat upon, for him to be nailed to a cross. And I want you to understand, he's called us to follow him. The source of our conflict is ourself. Jesus Christ does not bring salvation to our souls for us to do what we want to do and get him to come along with us. I want you to be reminded of God's word that we have been bought at a price, and I want you to understand that the price of our salvation, it is much more than gold and silver and fine jewels. It is with the precious blood of God's one and only Son, Jesus Christ. And he sets us free from sin, and he sets us free from ourselves for us to no longer live for ourselves, but for him who died for us and has been raised again. Dear friend, I want to remind us as the body of Christ, we are here for him, not us. We have been spoiled in this country for many decades. We have had and we continue to have abundance. But please notice the depravity of ourselves, our own flesh. No matter what God brings in our life, there's always a desire for more. You need to understand that's not the devil. That's me. That's that old man. That's who I truly am apart from Christ. Now, I want you to understand, God has set us free from the power of that. And He's given us the power from above, His Holy Spirit to live within us. But I want you to understand that the battle that goes on, this conflict that's going on in your heart every day is between your will and His will. Do you know why people don't come to church? I don't want to. Do you know why people retire from serving God? Because I don't want to. Listen, I want to be ministered to. I want people to minister to me. I want to be a part of this audience. Dear friend, I want you to remind the church today, listen, we're going to see the glory and the magnificence of God. Listen, we are going to be there worshiping Him and praising Him and extolling Him and magnifying Him forever and ever and ever. But until that time comes, we are here to serve the living God. We are here to be light in the world. We are here to set ourselves aside and live unto Him. What I'm telling you is God has a purpose and a plan for your life as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's not going to have anything to do with what you want to do. There are many that have adopted the philosophy of this world that Paul warned the church at Colossians not to be deceived by, that, listen, God wants me to be comfortable. God does not want me to be put out. Dear friend, I want you to understand part of growing up is dying to yourself. Being mature in Christ is that your life becomes less and less and less and less about you and more and more and more about the Lord Jesus Christ and His kingdom and His work and will in other people, even at your expense. You know how I know that? God's Word says that, and Jesus Christ is our example. Listen, He became obedient to death, even death on the cross. And if you look at verse 3 and 4 of chapter 2 in Philippians there, before that attitude is displayed that we are to have in Christ Jesus, Paul says to the church there in Philippi, he says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourself. Dear friend, I want you to understand, if spouses would quit fighting for themselves and start fighting for the other, the conflict would cease. You take two individuals and you bring them into a marriage. They've been standing up and fighting for what they wanted their whole life. But listen, for two to become one, it's no longer about me and me. It's about us for His glory. And both have to give. And where do we give? Listen, we give our flesh, our desires, our want at the authority of God's Word for Him to be glorified in our home, for Him to have His will, His way, His purpose, His plan in our life. Dear friend, I want you to understand, it's not about your dreams. It's about God's will for your life. If you are blessed to have a spouse here today, let me tell you something. You get blessed tremendously in that relationship, but God didn't bring you together just for you. He brought you together to be a team for His glory. And I want you to understand that His will is not for you just to sit in a church pew and tell everybody what I want you to do. This is the music I want. This is the order of worship I want. This is what makes me feel good. This is what makes me happy. Dear friend, I want you to understand, God's not in heaven seeking to make me happy. He's seeking to make me holy. And he's not here to make you happy. He's here to make you holy. Peter says, be holy, for the Lord thy God is holy. God cares more about your holiness, and you and I can't be holy as long as we keep living for ourselves. Can't do it. I want you to understand this conflict that's going on in you. Every day is God's Spirit saying, lay yourself down, and here's what I want you to do. Listen, you want to get revenge. God says, I want you to show them love and grace, forgiveness. You're saying, man, I'm not going to put up with that. And God's saying, look, be long-suffering. Be patient. Listen, that battle is not the devil. That battle's not demons. That battle's not this world. That battle's not him or her. Listen, that's you. That's me. That's who we are. Yes, God lives within me. Yes, I am saved for eternity. But let me tell you something. He's working through a fallible vessel, and that's me. Listen, there's a lot of conflict that we're praying to God, please settle it. And he says, I would if you'd get out of the way. If you would quit thinking that it's all about you, and you being happy and everybody doing what you want them to do, and you would submit to my authority, if you would humble yourself, I'll lift you up. Listen, it's me. It's me wanting to lift myself up. That's not the devil. That's me. Do you understand? That's in every person in this place. It's not just you in that battle. Every person that knows Jesus Christ, this is a battle going on day in and day out in your workplace, in your home, in your community. You know why you get so mad at things going on in this country? It's because you got a purpose. It's because you got a plan. It's because you want it to work out the way you want it to work out, and you're not okay with God working it out however he wants to. You've had freedom. You've had liberties. And how dare somebody take that from me? Do you understand that has nothing to do with God being glorified? Do you understand that's not God doing that? Well, God wants us to fight for our country. God wants you to die to yourself and him to fight through you for his kingdom. May I please remind you today of some truth that we all need to get our heads and hearts wrapped around? Listen, Jesus Christ did not come lay down his life for America. Do you understand? This country is not eternal. This country, along with every country on planet Earth, is coming to an end that God has foretold. It's all going to be burned up. Do you believe that? Do you believe that God's kingdom is eternal and not in this world? Listen, there's a gospel in our country today that says that God sent his son so that you can be happy, you can be healthy, you can get everything you want. Listen, you can live the life you want to live. And listen, you can drag God along with you to get him to bless what you want to do. Dear friend, I want you to understand that is not another gospel. That is no gospel at all. We have conflict. And it starts right here. Paul told the church in Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 and following, so I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of your sinful nature. For your sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit. And the Spirit, listen to me, what is contrary to the sinful nature, they are in opposition so that you do not do what you want. Tonight, Every person in this place is going to know this battle. It's going to be 5:30. And you're going to be thinking, man, I sure do want to just put on my PJs and kick back and just veg out so I can be rested for tomorrow. Yet you know down deep in your soul, listen, God says, do not forsake the assembling of yourself together. That God wants you to come together. God wants us as His people to corporately worship and exalt Him and seek His face and pray, listen, and pray. And pray His house is to be a house of prayer. And here's how it plays out. Oh, honey, you know, you ain't feeling too good. Didn't I hear you have a little scratchy sniffle or something? Baby, let's just stay here. And tomorrow in the workplace, there's going to be a situation that comes up. You know it's going to be a spiritual battle, and God has you right there in that place to stand and to be salt and light, for you to stand up and to proclaim the truth. And listen, this battle's going to go on in your head, and it's going to go on in your heart. Oh, man, it ain't. I shouldn't say it. Who am I? Man, I want them to like me. I don't want to rub anybody the wrong way. Man, I'm not supposed to do that. Will you please explain to me why Jesus stood up and told the truth, even though it cut completely against the heart of mankind? The battle's going on in you. The battle's going on in me. And every day, listen to me, we are making decisions. Am I going to live for me or Christ? See, here's what we want. Here's what all of us want. I'm under God's grace. It doesn't matter what I'm doing day in and day out. As long as I go to church and as long as I tithe and do some religious stuff, God's okay. Dear friend, I want you to understand, God created us for a daily personal relationship. Your faith in Christ is not just lived out on Sunday morning and Wednesday night. Your faith in Christ is to be lived out every day of your life, in your home, in your community, in your workplace, and this conflict is going on, and you are making decisions either to please yourself or to please the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, stop singing how I love Jesus when you're living for yourself. Because we deceive ourselves by what we say. And listen, we can come together and you not see my heart and me not see your heart, and we can say, oh, how we love Jesus. And every day the Spirit of God is convicting me. I want you to stand here. I want you to go there. I want you to set that down in your life. Listen, I want to do this in your life. Here's my call for you. Here's my purpose for you. And we are saying to Him time and time and time and time and time again, no, 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 no. Do you know how many people that I have come across in ministry that God called them to preach? And they say, you know what, I don't want to leave my retirement. I don't want to leave my family. Well, bless your heart. Bless your heart. You think I wanted to leave mine? Do you think Jesus wanted to leave His? Dear friend, I want you to understand, when we come to faith in Christ, it is no longer about me. It's about Him. It's about His glory and His will. Do you understand you have a very short time on this earth to serve the living God? Do you understand this is once in an eternal lifetime? Listen, opportunity to live on this earth and to serve the King of Kings, to tell people about it. Do you know your time is growing short? And it will come to an end one day. And listen, all of it, I wish I'd done more. I wish I'd yielded to God. All that's going to be gone. And day after day, the enemy, he is stealing and stealing and stealing, because we don't want to inconvenience ourselves. We don't want to tell ourselves no. We will stand and tell our children no. Why? Because that's not what's best for them. And God's trying to get us to stand up and be His people. We have been called in Christ Jesus to be His people and for Him to be our God. And Him being our God is just not us verbally saying He's our God. Him being our God means that He is in control of our life. He is in control of our meetings. He is in control of where we go and what we do. Listen, He is in control. We are not. The source of our conflict, it's me. James says in James chapter 1, when tempted, no one should say that God's tempting me, for God cannot be tempted, nor does He tempt anyone. But each one is led away and enticed by his own evil desires. And when desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin. Sin is disobedience to God. Do you understand that if God's called you to teach Sunday school, He's called you to serve in this body of believers, to keep children or to teach little people, do you understand that when you say, no, God, I am not, I am going to retire. Listen, my life and our family life, it's just too busy for you, God. Somebody else needs to do that. Do you understand that sin? Do you understand? Listen, using drugs and lying and committing adultery, that's not all that's sin. Listen, disobedience is sin. Adam and Eve didn't commit adultery. They didn't murder anybody. They disobeyed God. They partook of a fruit God said, do not. When desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin. And listen to me, church. You want to know what's going on in America? When sin is full grown, it gives birth to death. You want to know what's happening in our country? Please, we need to hear this, and we need to embrace this truth. It's not Republicans. It's not Democrats. It's not those folks. Dear friend, I want you to understand what God does in a country. It begins with His people. We can quote it. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, listen to me, and turn from their wicked ways, then I'll hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sin, and what does He say? I will heal their land. It doesn't matter who's in the president's office, it doesn't matter who's in the Senate, it doesn't matter who's in the House. I want you to understand, I'm talking to you today about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You understand that He is the everlasting God. He's the one and only God. He spoke, and everything that there is came into being. I want you to understand, listen, instead of you fighting for what you want, if we would humble ourselves and pray, God can change this nation. And all He has to do is speak, and it's not even a sweat to Him. He won't even lose 1 minute of sleep. Lord, get them right. Lord, get them right. Lord, get them right. And He's saying, I want to get you right, church. I want my people right. I want you coming for me, not you. I'm wanting you to come to see me, not to be seen. I'm wanting you to come and worship me, not have someone perform for you. You understand God's audience here? Not us. He is. Well, I just can't sing. Let me tell you something. I can't carry a tune in a bucket. But let me tell you something. May I hush and give in to this old world if I don't stand and proclaim praise and exaltation to my God and King. There's conflict. Everybody in here knows this. When you're laying on your bed at night, man, when nobody's seeing you and man, you got that phone burning a hole in your pocket and you want to get on Facebook and tell them the whatnot, When you're wanting to pull up that mess on your phone, man, when you're wanting to text that person, you know, you, man, that war is going on. And it's you. It's me. We are the problem. We are the ones that need to come and bow before God and say, dear God, I am a mess. I am wicked. I am rebellious. Even though you saved me, this flesh, I'm the weak link in your process. I need you to change my heart. Listen, I need you to change my ways, God. I can't do it. I need you. Not just on Sunday. I need you every day. Do you understand? I can't have the right attitude any day without him. Listen, I don't even know the right way to go without him. It's not my intellect. It's our heart. The source of our conflict is our desire. We desire something, and we don't get it. She doesn't do what I wanted her to do. He doesn't do what I want him to do. Sound familiar? It should for every person in this place. They're not doing what I want them to do. He says, so you murder. Man, I haven't murdered anybody. Oh, no. We may not pick up a gun and shoot them, but let me tell you something. We'll whoop out our tongue. We'll whoop out our Facebook and Twitter. And we'll make sure everybody knows just how awful they are. Do you understand that slander? Do you understand that is killing the character? That's murder. Oh, I love her. I love him. Yeah, but as soon as we don't get our way, son, I'll be talking to them like they're a dog. Do you understand that husbands and wives, they talk at each other like, man, they're arch enemies. You know why? Because we're not getting our way. Desire something and don't have, so we murder and we covet. We envy. We want. We want. You know, that's envy. I want. There ain't nothing wrong with what I want. Yes, it is, if it's something besides what God wants. You covet and cannot obtain, so you quarrel and fight. You ain't gonna get it. You can't have it. You're gonna make sure everybody around you know that you're unhappy. You know where that comes from? That's me. That's you. He says you do not have because you do not ask God. And the reason we don't ask God is one of two reasons. Most of the time, not all the time, but most of the time it's one of two reasons. I don't really think God can do it. Because if I did, I'd go ask him. Right? God, will you change this nation? Would you change the heart of our president? Would you be with him? Would you be with our vice president? Would you be with the Senate? God, would you change their heart? Would you move their hearts even in spite of whatever they believe? God, would you move them for your glory? Listen, a lot of us don't pray because we don't believe God can do anything. We don't go and ask God to change the heart of our spouse, change the heart of our children. You know why? Because we think we need to do it. We don't really think God can do it. If we did think God could do it, we'd go talk to him about it. That's believing God. Either we don't believe God can do it, or we know it's not his will anyway, and we're certainly not going to talk to him about that. You do not ask because you do not ask God. James says, when you ask, you do not receive. Why? Because you want to spend what you get on your own pleasure. Listen, God doesn't just care about our outside dressing up, looking pretty in front of each other. Do you understand? He cares about the motive of our heart. The attitude that we're coming and asking him and praying to him things for. Listen, Our motives matter. And you know, when I have the wrong motive, it's foolish for me to act like it's not there and try to dress that up and make you think I'm something I'm not. Man, you know, when my motive is not right, I go to God and I say, God, please change my motives, because I can't do that. Lord, I know that attitude that I got, it is wrong. God, I know that that is displeasing to you. I know I am asking you to do this for myself and myself only, or for my family and my family only. God, please change my motive. For my prayer to be about your glory, and my prayers to be about your name and your kingdom. Listen, I've got to be real with this. I can't pretend and dress up and just keep on acting like I've got it together. I don't. I'm a mess. I need God to keep working on me. I need God to help me to die so that He can live more. Notice the result of pursuing our desires. And we see it in verse 4 and 5. Look in verse 4. I know it's stout. I know we want to gloss over it. He says, you adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is hostility towards God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself, it ain't the devil, he makes himself an enemy of God. Do you understand that me as a child of God continuing to demand what I want and what I think in my life, do you understand that is a spiritual adultery against God? Listen, when we give our passion for the things of this world, when we put the things of this world in my desires, oh, it's my weekend. It's my hobby. It's my habit. Oh, God knows that we're all sinners. You know what that is? That is simply us saying that, God, you can't change me. And He can. Listen, John says in 1 John chapter 5, if we ask anything according to His will, we know that He hears us. And if we know that He hears us, we know that we have what it is that we ask of Him. Listen, if we have things in our life, and listen, I'm not here throwing stones. Listen to me. I've had all kinds of idols and gods in my life. Son, I used to chase after hunting and fishing. You can ask my poor wife. She'd get left at home to do everything at the house. And listen, that was my time. That was my hobby. That was mine. That was mine. And boy, let me tell you, I couldn't wait till deer season opened. Boy, I'd count the days down. But man, I tell you what, I'd get up day after day after day not wondering, what is my Lord going to do? What kind of opportunities is God going to bring in my life? How's God going to work in my life? Do you understand that when we're passionate about this world, the things of this world, behind God, when's the last time you lost sleep? Listen, waiting for the next day, not knowing what God's going to say to your soul. Not knowing what He's going to do in your children's life and your grandchildren's life. Not knowing what He's going to do in your workplace. When's the last time? Listen, we have all these other passions, all these other things, and you need to understand that spiritual adultery. And we all come out of this. This is who we are before we're saved. And I want you to understand, God accepts us with all of our baggage, all of our garbage, all of our rebellion against Him. When we turn from this world and we yield to Christ, He saves us completely. We're forgiven all of our sin. And listen, that salvation, that sanctifying work is something we are to be willing participants in, being driven along by His love. Me saying no to me. You say, man, it's hard. I want it so bad. Listen, we're all starting to sound like addicts. You hear me? Don't you tell me God cannot become more than heroin. Don't tell me God can't fill the void of meth abuse. Don't you dare tell me that God cannot remove an adulterous heart. Don't you dare tell me that God can't make Himself a bigger passion in my life and in my family than hunting and fishing and shopping and money and power. Listen to me. All these things are going by the wayside. Open our eyes. It is spiritual adultery, and we gloss it over, and we laugh about it, and we can even come up in God's house, and boy, we can be all passionate about those things, and we'll speak very little about what Jesus did in my life this week. Man, did you know God told me Tuesday morning? Do you know that as I was going through this week, man, God gave me an opportunity to share my faith with this person? Man, did you know this week God changed the desire in my spouse or in my children to be more like Him? Man, we don't want to talk 10 minutes about that. But man, if the fish are biting. Now look, I'm not knocking these things to the point that, man, if you fish, you're wrong. I ain't saying that. Please don't hear that. If you go deer hunting, praise the Lord. Go deer hunting. But I want you to understand that by the power of God's Spirit, they need to be in the right place in our life. And He needs to be first. And we need to make plans, just like James goes on to say, if it's the Lord's will, we'll go here and do this. But if it's not God's will, that ain't happening. We need to understand that our passion, listen, pouring ourselves into all of these things, it is spiritual adultery. Now, I know what I've just said. Some of you are there and saying, man, I didn't come to be beat up. And I'm not telling you what God's word says to beat you up. I'm telling you what God says because we don't know we have a need for Dr. Jesus until we recognize we're sick. And as long as I keep, listen, being the one killing God's work in my life, blaming other people, I'll never be open to the path of peace. And there's a path of peace here that I want to share with you tonight. That I'm telling you, every person in this place can join God in, and I promise you, He can bring peace that surpasses understanding in your heart, in your life, in your marriage, in your family, in your community, in your workplace. Man, God can do it. He desires to do it. But He's not going to do it as long as I don't recognize where the conflict comes from and how serious it is in my life. And I promise you, I'm not picking on you. This is every born-again believer. This is the truth of how bad we need God every day. So bad. Man, I need to hear from my Father. I need the power of God to give me the possibility, listen, to have the mind of Christ and the attitude of Christ. Listen, I need God's Spirit to convict me when I step out of line and I say something wrong, to go back and apologize. Listen, to seek to give testimony to the Lord Jesus Christ. I need Him, listen, showing me where He's working and compelling me by His love to join Him in that, to continue the calling and the plan that He has for my life. Listen, I so desperately need Him. I can't lean on experience. I can't lean on things God has done. I need God just as much today, and I'm being made more aware just how bad I need Him with every passing day that passes. But listen, to recognize my need, I have to deal with the truth of who I am apart from Him. So let me ask you, and it is a loaded question, because I already know the truth, and God, our Father, already knows the truth. Is there a conflict in your life? And you don't have to answer out loud. Matter of fact, I'd prefer you didn't. Let me answer for all of us. With us being honest, the answer is yes. So the next question is this: who or what have you been blaming for your conflict? Because let me tell you something, every one of us in here, we can see it in other people, but we don't want to see it in me. Is God trying to bring peace in your life, in your soul? Listen, you have to understand that the problem is me. Dear friend, I want to remind us that's the only way we can be saved. Is to recognize I'm the problem. I'm the sinful person. I'm the rebellious person. I am hopeless and I am helpless without a loving, eternal, kind King. Listen, making a way of salvation and calling me to Himself. Listen, to turn from my life and yield to Him for salvation. And without His grace, I don't have a hope. But listen, understanding who I am, I'm open to what He offers. And let me tell you, when I understand just how lost I am, the gospel's good news. It doesn't matter if I've heard it preached 18 billion times. It's still the greatest news I've ever heard. And you know what? You may have conflict in your life, and you have your whole life. And like guys that come into the ministry, you may think it was your daddy or your mama or this society. Nobody's been making the decision in your life but you. And without God moving and bringing salvation, I can't change me. I can't do better. I can't get better. And listen, if God's trying to bring peace in your soul, salvation today, listen, please listen to me. You can't do that. But God, through His precious Son, Jesus Christ, can. And I don't care what you've done. I don't care how bad it is, how embarrassed you are over it. He offers forgiveness at the foot of the cross for all. And I promise you, at yielding and crying out to Jesus, He'll pour His peace in you that will surpass your understanding. He will fill your heart with joy that you have never had, not one day on this earth. But listen to me, you can have the rest of your days on this earth and into eternity. And if He's calling and drawing you, today if you hear His voice, come. And for the church, listen, Every one of us are still works in progress. Paul said, I have not achieved all of this or have been made perfect. If Paul wasn't, I tell you what, I ain't. And you're not either. And is there conflict in your life? It's not her fault. It's not his fault. It's your own desires. And I assure you, God jealously longs for the spirit he's put in you. And he accepted you just as you were. But he has every intention for you to die daily, that he becomes more and more in your life. Is there areas of desire in your life that you know God's wanting to get out of your life? Dear friend, I want you to understand that if you'll acknowledge that and if you'll confess that, he'll be faithful. He'll be faithful to cleanse you and purify you from all unrighteousness. Listen, you may today just made the connection God did by his spirit in your heart that it's adultery against God. There may be hobbies. There may be habits that God wants to move out of your life. And I want you to understand, you don't need to think it ain't a big deal. It's a big deal to God. And I promise you, listen to me, what you think you're giving up can't even compare to what he's wanting to bring into your life. It can't even compare, because what you're trying to hold on to is temporary, and what he wants to bring in your life is eternal. And I promise you, he will fill your soul with himself, and he's so much better. Today you may need to come to an altar, setting down pride, saying yes to God's spirit that's drawing you, and saying no to yourself, your own desires. You may need to do that and come and cry out to the Lord Jesus for salvation. You may need to go to somebody around you and ask for forgiveness for being the source of the conflict that's been going on. Dear friend, I want you to understand the living God is in this place. And he is here to heal. He is here to forgive. And he is here to grow you in your faith and draw you closer to him. But self has to be set down. And you have to say yes to his spirit. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I do thank you, Lord, for this time. And Lord, I do thank you for your word. I thank you, God, that you tell us truth, whether we like it or not. And Father, you tell us, Lord, not for our hurt and harm, but God, you tell us so that we may be made well, Lord, by you. Father in heaven, I do pray, God, that the hearts that you have stirred in this place today, Lord, I pray that they would say no to their desire and they would say yes to Jesus. And Father, as each one does, Lord Jesus, may you be exalted. May you be praised. May you be pleased with our worship. And I pray it in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, spoken to your heart, would you come? The altar's open. If you need someone to pray with you, please come. The only thing stopping any of us is me. Say yes to him.
pray today as we go our way this afternoon, as we go our homes, our meal, that our prayer will be, when we heed this word, the word today, that draws us closer to what God would have us to be, what our own desires are. And that's what I've got to do today. Don't forget to be back tonight with a heart full of continuous blessings and the peace that we can find in God's word. We'll get back to that at 6 o'clock. Anything we need to mention before this meeting?